My name is Susan Rubin. I'm a clinical psychologist in sleep medicine at Yale, and I'm here to talk to you about managing sleepless nights. Sleep is variable. It's always going to be variable from night to night, and science recognizes that there are differences in individuals and across nights. Insomnia is different from normal sleep in that there are persistent and consistent difficulties in sleep, and that can take the form of difficulty falling asleep, difficulty staying asleep or being awake for too long during the night, or waking up too early and not being able to return to sleep. One of the hallmarks that we look for in really recognizing whether this is a problem for individuals is that there are also daytime consequences. That's a hallmark of actual clinical insomnia. Our experience is you get into bed and you go to sleep. For people who don't have difficulty with sleep, you get into bed and you go to sleep, you get into bed, you go to sleep, you wake up in the middle of the night and you go back to sleep. And that's their learning history. For people who have difficulty with sleep, however it is that they got there, whether it's, you know, they brought a new baby into the home or they had a stressful job or whatever the pathway is to getting there, their experience is they get into bed and they toss and turn, they wake up in the middle of the night and they toss and turn, they can't go back to sleep, they toss and turn. And that's what their bodies learn, and that's what their brains learn. And through repeated pairings of being in bed and tossing and turning, and being in bed and tossing and turning, the bed and the bedroom and the act of going to bed actually acquire the capacity to kind of create arousal and awakening. And that learned habit, that bodily learned habit, like any other habit, becomes persistent over time. CBTI is cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia. It addresses both thoughts and expectations about sleep and behaviors around sleep during the night when we can't sleep. There are a couple of different components of cognitive behavioral therapy. The first is called stimulus control therapy. Again, that's not a helpful name, right? What it really means is that we're taking control of that association between being in bed and not sleeping and that control, and we're gonna change it. So what we do is stimulus control has two basic rules to it. The first rule is really that beds are for sleep only. We want to get rid of this association, the being in bed and tossing and turning, the being in bed and not being able to sleep, being in bed and being frustrated, and being in bed and being aroused. So we really want to separate out and carve out the bed and the bedroom as a place for sleep. The second part of that is that when you're not sleeping, because beds are for sleep only, you need to go someplace else and do something else for a period of time until you recognize that your natural sleep drive is starting to kick in and you start to feel sleepy or drowsy, and then go back to the bedroom to go to sleep. That's the first component of CBTI. The second component also is called sleep restriction, which sounds just mean-spirited, right? Why are you restricting my sleep when I'm already having difficulty sleeping? What it is actually restriction of time in bed. We want to compress the amount of sleep that individuals are getting. So if you're getting 6 hours of sleep over 9 hours in bed, that doesn't feel so good because you've got big patches of wakefulness. We want to compress your time in bed and compress your sleep so that you get it in one big dose. And we work with individuals to manage both of those factors at the same time to improve their sleep. It is a treatment strategy that is very effective. When folks work on stimulus control therapy, there's a latency to response. It takes a little bit of time to start to see the benefit, but the benefits are enduring, and we know that once people have changed their sleep habits and patterns, those gains are maintained and in fact extended over time. A couple of takeaway ideas that are important for folks to know is that it's normal to have difficulty sleeping, particularly under times of stress. If it becomes persistent and consistent, there's help available. I would encourage people to reach out to their primary care physician or to a sleep disorder center if they're experiencing ongoing difficulty with sleep.